Jessie, and this is the Knit Up and Dye Podcast, episode 19, Shop Talk. I've got a whole bunch of little different things to talk to you folks about today, as well as some information about my business and my dyeing and how I do that in response to a question I received recently. So let's dive in. I actually have a cheat sheet because I got so many different things I need to chase around today. First thing I want to remind you all about is the Travel Knitting Giveaway. That's being hosted on my Knit Up and Dye podcast group on Ravelry. Please, it's free to enter. What I'm looking for is suggestions about what project I should knit on a future road trip I've got coming up. And I really just was looking for something creative, something new, and I'm putting the power into your hands. You get to pick the project for me. If I pick your project, you win a free skein of yarn of your choice from my shop. If I don't pick your project, you still have a chance to win. What's going to happen is I'm going to do a random drawing of all the entries, less who the winner was, and randomly draw another winner. So everybody has a chance to win. And this is open internationally. Thank you to Carrie in New South Wales, Australia. Hi, Carrie. I did want to let everyone know, just because you're across the planet from me doesn't mean I can't get yarn to you. And certainly, you're welcome to enter as well. I'd love to hear your suggestions. The drawing will end on Friday, February 10th. That's this coming Friday. And I'll be announcing the winners in the next podcast. So hop on over and enter. I can't wait to see what you suggest. There have been some really interesting suggestions. I'm trying very hard not to look because I don't want to be unfair about it. I want to look at everybody all at the same time, give everybody equal consideration. I don't want to look at it too early and fall in love with a project and start to plan to do that and not give somebody else's suggestion a fair shake. So I'm trying not to look. Don't ask me if I loved it. Forgive me. I need some water. In other news, I've made an executive decision. Among the bases that I sell in my shop, I have a lace weight base. As much as I like the base, it's not a strong seller, and I don't knit enough with lace to have tons of it around, which sounds really selfish, but ultimately, if my yarns don't sell, they're my yarns, and I'll need to be able to do something with them. So I'm actually going to take a break from my lace weights. I'm going to discontinue my lace weight line for a while, unless I start getting a lot of requests for lace weight again. This is a good thing for you. If you love my lace weights, please pop on over to the shop. I have already reduced the prices. They are priced to sell. Pop over. They are limited quantities remaining at this point. However, I do still have a couple of skeins that are undyed, so if you have a favorite colorway and you would love to see that on a lace weight, now is the time to place a custom order with me. Custom orders! So I want to shout out and thank Nancy, Kylie, Kate, Leanne, Kristen, and Kim. You folks are located all over the planet, and I love sending you yarn, as well as I love filling your custom orders. And I want to just kind of give everyone some information about how a custom order works. If you aren't seeing something that you want in my shop, if you want a colorway on a different base, if you want a sweater quantity, if you live halfway across the world and you look at the shipping and you go, it's higher than if I just make the yarn myself and feed the sheep. I get it. And I don't ever want shipping to be the reason that you don't purchase. Unfortunately, Etsy is a little clunky in how their system works for shipping. If you need multiple skeins, please convo me through Etsy. Let me create a custom order for you and let me save you some money on shipping. If you see a colorway but it's not on the right base, convo me. I will create it on the right base for you. If you need sweater quantity and you want it on a certain color, on a certain base, whatever, I'm going to do everything I can to fulfill your knitting and crochet dream. So please pop on over to Etsy. If you're not seeing it there, if you want to take advantage of the last few skeins of lace, send me a message. And with the custom color orders, and this is tricky. So if it's a color that you dream of, but you're not seeing that colorway there, that doesn't mean I can't create it for you. I'm happy to design a color for you. With one thing in mind, color is a very, very subjective thing. And proof of that is look at a color and ask your husband or your wife what color it is, and they may describe it differently than you do. Everybody's eyes work a little bit differently. Everybody's brain works a little bit differently. We all perceive color a little bit differently. So when you say blue, well, blue has 900 million shades, I'm pretty sure. But if you say something very specific, I may misinterpret that. So if you would like a custom color made, absolutely, I will do everything in my power to make that color for you. However, try to provide me with a real-world example. So, for instance, if you have a particular shade of orange in mind, and you're thinking, oh, it's like a heirloom tomato. Which breed? One of my greatest reference points is Crayola crayons. They come in a bazillion shades. If you have a Crayola crayon that is the color you want, tell me which color Crayola crayon it is. If it's a particular shade of paint, if it is a particular shade of pencil, let me know what that color is, because I can then have a real world sample here in my studio to base your color against. I just absolutely want to make sure that it's a color that you're happy with and not a color that I've misinterpreted. So, there, that's the little bits. Also coming up very soon, I'm very excited, we have our Intention Knitting Knit Along coming up. So yesterday, I shipped out all the orders that I've already received. You should be receiving your yarn very shortly, and I should be distributing the pattern later this week to you. We kick off next Sunday. If that doesn't work for your schedule, that's fine. It's a knit along. It's knit when you want to, and it's knit with your intention in mind. This is a very selfish project. It is about you, completely about you. And the whole point of this is to give you a focused project to bring your intention, your peace of mind into and project into the project through a little bit of focal and meditative knitting where you intentionally track your thought patterns and put those emotions and those vibrations into your work. I have the Good Vibration sock pattern that I'm supplying with the yarn. This is part of your knit along kit. And it's a simple pattern, it really is a simple pattern, but it's designed to kind of break up the colors a little bit so we don't get too stripey. And at the same time, be mindless enough that you have the opportunity to really focus on your intention that you're putting into your project. I hope you enjoy it. Certainly, if it's not the project for you, do whatever you want. That's the whole point of this. It's about you. There are some kits left. If you are just now catching up with us and you're interested in doing this, please hop over to the Etsy shop today and grab your kit. These are four of the three colors. These are the four colors that remain. I'm not showing them very well. Let me see if I can shift my hands. These are the four colors that remain. Hop on over. These will be available again later in my shop, but at this time, these are the kits that are remaining. So buzz on over and grab one if you want one now. Also, on my Ravelry group for the Intention Knit Along kit, Knit Along, we're going to have a live chat next Sunday. You're welcome to join me. If you're not already a member of Ravelry, it's free to sign up. Take advantage. It's an amazing resource. If you go to the Knit Up and Die podcast group, there is a button up on the right that's the chat thread. By simply clicking on that, it'll drop you into our live chat. I'll be starting at 1 p.m. Mountain Standard Time. Please check the group for information for other time zones. I should be there for 2, maybe 3 hours answering your questions, just having a general chin wag with you. Hi, it's great to see you. I'd love to talk to you. I'd love to meet you. If you have time, pop on over. It would be great fun during our cast on to get together with other members of the group. And certainly if you're not part of the knit along, but you'd like to pop in anyway and just see what we're all about, come on in. We'd love to have you. There's not rules here about that. That takes care of all the little business bits. I made some progress this week. I'm so ridiculously excited about this. I talked to you folks about my sweater. If you're new to the group, here's the story. I am cursed. I apparently have very strange dimensions, and every sweater I have ever knit has been a nightmare. It has not fit me properly. I have tried to work with patterns that you measure yourself, and then the patterns generated off of those measurements. Apparently, both my husband and I are incapable of properly measuring me. I have a curse. I can knit anything in the world. I have knit dog sweaters without patterns. I have knit socks. I have knit hats, shawls, leg warmers for a cat. Don't ask, it was weird. I have knit a bizarre a range of things, but for some reason I'm incapable of knitting a sweater. Until now, we hope. So I've been working on a sweater of my own devising. I'm not using a pattern. I am creating a drop shoulder sweater that is basically 4 rectangles. There is a rectangle for the front of me, there is a rectangle for the back of me, there's a rectangle for one arm and a rectangle for the other arm. And it should be boxy, it should be comfortable, it should be a success. It should be a success. And I'm feeling very much that it is. Progress is going really, really well. When I mock it up and I hold it up against myself, I'm happy with the result. And I have huge high hopes that this is going to finish very soon. I'd like to take it on my road trip with me. And I'll be able to move on to another sweater. And the curse will be done. I'm ridiculously excited about this. So last week I showed you that I had the front done and I had the back done, and I had managed to graft the shoulders together, which was a mixed Kitchener. I had never done a mixed Kitchener before. That was really interesting. I learned a lot. It's a technique that I'm going to have to revisit. I think the one thing that I'm most stumped by is the mixed Kitchener seems to be a half a stitch off, and that may be my error. It may be how I interpreted the instructions or something that I did. So I'll be revisiting that. For this project, you're never going to see that half stitch. It's not going to matter, and I'm content with the results. So that won't be the reason that I don't like this sweater. For the mixed Kitchener information, when I was researching how I was going to graft this together because I want it to be a reversible sweater, I went to my Principles of Knitting book. It's on my shelf here. I'm reviewing it sideways. June Hemmons Hyatt wrote this. I'm going to pull it up for you. There isn't a question about knitting that cannot be answered by this book. Oh, goodness. It's a monster. I love this book. It's a little sun faded, forgive me. I live in the desert, sun is everything. This book, it's a monster. It has everything. The only thing that I would caution people about who are trying to get information from this is that it is not written for a beginner. The vocabulary in it is technical. They do address that in here. They do have a reasonable glossary, if you will. through, not really a glossary. A glossary would be a huge, huge benefit to this book. I lie, there's a glossary. That would have been useful for me to notice ages ago. But it does have excellent cross-referencing and really discusses... I have not found a question this book doesn't answer, with the exception of perhaps dyeing. I've never looked in here for dyeing information. You would think that would have occurred to me too. So, no, I'm going to say that there's nothing in here about dyeing. It is methods and techniques of hand knitting. Excellent, excellent, highly recommended. It is a beast. It is definitely a nice, hefty resource. Give it a try. If you're really addicted and you want to be able to do everything, roadmap. So, moving on. I did use that for my grafting techniques. I'm very excited about how it came out. I showed you the front, I showed you the back, I showed you that I had grafted together the shoulder, and that I had picked up and started a sleeve. That was last week. That was this sleeve. Yay! I'm so excited. I knit the whole sleeve this week. Yay! It is there, it is done. The second sleeve is picked up, it's moving along beautifully. I'm happy with the length. I did put the cuff on waste yarn. I'm going to seam this up. I'm going to seam it from the hem up under the arm and extend out to the arm. And I'm going to stop with it live. I'm going to try this on and I'm going to determine a final cuff length. The beauty of sleeve top down is you can adjust that either by tearing back or adding a little bit more. And that process is already set up. I've got my lifeline in place. Thrilled, thrilled, can't wait to do this. The only sticking point I have that I'm feeling nervous about is finishing the collar. So I have all of my live stitches on waste yarn so that I can easily put those back on the needle and just pick up any place that had a vertical edge. But I'm not sure how I want to finish it. And because this is so self-designed, I don't really have a reference to go against. Is that a problem? No. Yes. There's too many choices. There's too many options. And that's where I'm stuck, is just too many options. Because this is reversible, I want it to have a reversible collar as well. And it really, truly is coming out beautifully reversible. There's the join at the shoulder. And when I flip it around to the high texture side, there's the join at the shoulder. I am very happy with this. I think this looks wonderful. But I want the neck to be consistent and to work with this as well. So I'm toying with two different ideas. And certainly, if something occurs to you, if you know a better way, weigh in. Leave me a message here. Leave me a message over on Ravelry. Email me. I'd love to hear from you. Your input is always helpful. One of two ideas occur to me. I'm either going to pick up and do a short one-by-one rib, which is a little bit out of character with the rest of the sweater, but I don't think would be obtrusive. Or I'm going to pick up and I'm going to do an I-cord bind-off. I'm not sure if the I-cord bind-off will be fully reversible. I suspect it would work. I think it really depends on how many stitches are on my I-cord. But I think that it would reverse nicely. So it may be one of those things that I need to do a swatch for and kind of flip over and back and see how I like that. But I best be getting on that because I've already made huge progress on the sleeve, and the fact that I knocked this sleeve out this week indicates to me that I have less than a week to sort this out. So again, I am so encouraged by this, and I am just dreaming of my next sweater. The yarn is sitting over there. It's calling me. I can't wait. Just so delighted with this. Also, and this is kind of back into business chit-chat that I did earlier, with the discontinuation of the lace weight yarns in my shop, that gives me an opening. This was knit on a DK weight that was dyed by my dear friend Shannon over at Supernatural Yarns, and I love this base. I love this base. If it were socially acceptable and high fashion, I would knit a union suit out of this and wear it every day. It is t-shirt soft, and it's a wool. It has that comfy cotton feeling without that rip up your hand feeling. It is just soft and squishy and lovely, and I adore it. I adore it. So I've brought in this base, and I will begin dyeing this base. This base will be available in individual skeins. Again, it is a DK weight. It is a 100% fine superwash merino. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. 115 grams puts up, I think, I don't have a tag here. I don't remember. I want to say it's 235 yards. I think it's 235 yards. I could be wrong. And if I am wrong, I'll post it right here for you. But beautiful put up, beautiful hand, and I'll be putting it in the shop, available in individual skeins, as well as you're always welcome to order sweater quantities. I have dreams of multiple sweaters on this DK weight if I can make this work for me. Stupid curse. I want it gone. I want it gone. I'm going to break this. So the sweater has progress. Yay. Moving on, because you're tired of hearing about my sweater. I received a question in my email this past week. I think it's been a week. From Donna. Donna is at knittingwithattitude.com. She's got a shop coming up. If you haven't already had a chance to pop over to her website, take a look. There is so much potential with this. I love her attitude. I love how positive she is going into starting her business, and I can't wait to see what she does. This is an exciting time. I love seeing new companies bloom in this industry, and this one's going to come up like roses. This is wonderful. So Donna reached out to me. She said she has one question for me today. She loves sending questions, and it's usually like a bunch of questions at once. She's ready to start experimenting with her dyeing, and she has some bare yarns, dyes, equipment, etc., ready to go. There's a big part of her that wants to just jump in and play. But then, of course, the other part of her says that she needs to be very methodical and scientific and start test dyeing different snippets of yarn with different concentrations of dye and keep a very detailed notebook of her experiments so that she can learn and understand how different colors react on different fibers at different strengths before she begins to play with other colors on full skeins. She wants to know, will that knowledge come naturally from just playing, or do I have any recommendations? How did I approach dyeing when I first started? And that she would appreciate any advice on this. Donna, thank you so much for letting me share my answers with my other viewers. Certainly, anytime anybody has any questions, I am always going to be really open and tell you everything I know. This industry should not be a secret. This is art, and we're all going to do it differently, and we should all interact with each other and network and elevate our art as much as possible. So here it is. In answer to her question, which is an excellent question, by the way, especially if you're going into business, is that I always play. I always play. Sort of. So, because I dye with set skein counts, I'm going to read a little bit here from my answer because I took time to answer. All of my formulas are based on 2, 3, 4 skeins, and they're all 100 gram skeins, usually. The DK weight will have a little bit different formulas because those are 115 gram skeins. I measure my dyes dry with measuring spoons, and I'm the only one who ever works with my recipes. I don't have a specific scientific formula, but I do have a diary, quite literally, a diary, in which I keep all of my recipes. My recipes are notes regarding my methods, the pans that I use, the amount of water that I use, the amounts of each dye that I use, the temperatures I work with, how I apply the dye, whether I'm doing a wall pour like I've discussed with you guys before, or I do the pour on a door, or if I do the roasting pan blending kind of thing, or if I actually hand paint. All of that information gets trapped in my notebook. And whenever I re-dye something, I go back to my diary. Let me catch up to where I left off. So I also keep in my diary if when I'm playing I stumble on a color that I think would interact beautifully with another color that I've already stumbled on, I'll make notations about that for future dye projects, where I'll go ahead and I'll play again and I'll mix those colors together to see what reacts, what happens. I have a photographic history of every colorway that I've done, and I have the distinct luxury of a near photographic memory. How do I even express this? I have a very strong memory. I consider it a gift. Sometimes I consider it a curse because it gets really cluttered in here. But I can readily recall what I dyed, when I dyed it, what the colors look like. I can recall where I've written something down, and sometimes if I focus hard enough, I can actually see my handwriting and reread it in my head. It's a great advantage. Not everybody has this advantage, and therefore taking snippets of the yarn so that you have that beyond photographic evidence may work better for you. I don't keep snippets of my yarn. I sell my yarn. And if I recreate it, it's always going to be different. It's always going to shift a little bit. No matter how formulated my recipe is, the temperature in the room can change. The makeup of the chemicals in my water coming out of my tap can change. The dye lots from the different pots of dye that I purchase, even if it's the same color dye from my source, doesn't mean it's going to be identical from one run date to another. So, as an artist, I accept that these are going to vary, and I never try to reproduce exactly. Often they're very close, but I have to leave the angel share out there that fate will happen and things are going to be different. Also, I'm a small business. I have the luxury of offering very limited colorways. I sell myself strictly as a hand painter and dyer with all the variances that hand dyeing has to offer, like I just said. But I also have to keep costs to a minimum. I do not have the luxury of sitting down and winding off little bits of everything and taking the time to dye in every color possible. I just don't. It's an added expense. It may seem like a nominal added expense to some dyers. For me, it would be a hit, and I don't want to have to translate that over to higher cost yarns for you folks. If I were to start working in fiber bats, I think I would have to move to a much more scientific formula. But I'm speaking totally from a position of inexperience. I simply don't know how to dye on bats. I haven't dyed on bats. I know that weight is suddenly very important simply because I don't have a predetermined gram set in my hand. I'm going to have to measure things out. And I'm also told that raw fiber takes a lot more dye, so I suspect that my colorway formulas would be very different in that case. There are a number of professional dye books out there that say that you absolutely must have a color book, that you have to sit down, you have to scientifically formula all your colorways, you need to take business cards and wrap the yarn around it and label it with the recipe and everything. These color books are beautiful, their mini samples are stunning. I'm sure it is great fun to pull all the cards out and lay them down and mix colors that way. I recognize that there's the added expense of having to do it with every base that you have, because your colorway is going to be slightly different on every single base. It's going to react differently based on whether you have 20% nylon or 25% nylon, as well as when you start to mix silks in or bamboo, it's going to change the colorway. So I think these books are very nice. I think they're pretty. I love the organization of it. I am a crazy organization freak. I love to have everything in its place. You wouldn't know that looking at my studio right now, which is why my studio is not making me happy, because everything should be in its place. But I think the process of making that book is labor intensive. It's expensive in dollars and time, and I think it diminishes the glory of happy accidents. These are my opinions. It's kind of like trying to paint a Pollock with a computer. Planned random just isn't random. There have been so many yarns, so many colorways that I've created simply by playing, that I never would have mixed these colors together if I were being really scientific about it. And I think that that accidental magic is so important. I'm all about play, I guess. I was told by one dyer, the only dyer I know who does do a book, that this, by not having this book, it makes me less professional. Well, okay. I don't know how I feel about that. I don't like to judge other artists that way or put labels on people like that. If you sell your work, whether it is labor or a product, and somebody buys it, that is the definition of professional. If you make money with the act or the product, that is professional. And I'm not sure how I could be less professional simply because I have a different method. I've also been told by several dyers who don't do these color books that I'm being creative and thrifty, so whatever. Making a color book of your dye is for you. Ultimately, the choice is yours. My opinion, my 3-cent answer, is dive in, play, have fun, make colors that respond to you, that you respond to. Because if you don't love what you do, if this doesn't fill you up and make you crazy and make you want to do this for hours and make you want to call in sick to work, then that's when you're not doing it right. You should just find nothing but joy in your knitting, in your dyeing, in your spinning, in your weaving, in your crochet. If it's not bringing you joy, then is when you're doing it wrong. Clearly, I'm the dancing dye monkey. I believe firmly in playing with it. There's my opinion, there's my answer. Donna, thank you for asking. I say, honey, don't hold back. You dive in there, you start throwing dye, and you have fun, and you make your colorways, and pooey to the rules. That's that. With that having been said, let's review some resources. I love books. I love books, and I hate this age where we're eliminating books, because there's something incredibly tactile about books, whether it's the paper or the colors, that computer representations, digital representations of publications just don't have. I'm never going to sit in my bathtub sniffing a tablet. I love paper, I love books. I keep a diary, like I said. This is transcribed, my actual diary that I use in the kitchen. I'm grabbing them. Is a rotten mess. It is crazy scribbles and notes that indicate madness to me. It probably is indecipherable to most. Where I talk about my temperatures, I talk about my method, there's shorthand in here. I label my colorways as the names come to me in here if I hadn't already had one. and I talk about all the methods that I use. I then, when I'm happy with the colorway, transcribe it into the diary. If it makes it into the diary, it is a reproducible colorway that I can continue to do for you. If it doesn't make it into the diary, it was a one-off, I'm not going to be able to reproduce it, either because I didn't like the initial result and I dyed over it and the process became expensive and laborious to reproduce, or it just wasn't something I'm proud of. And often, those don't even make it to market. I will often dye over those until they are tolerable and use them myself. So there's that record-keeping method, if you will. And it's hysterical because when my son comes out to visit me, he often helps me dye. And some of the notes that I have in there, he's written for us. He's created some of his own colorways in there, and those pages are just precious to me because it's his handwriting and it's his capture of what we did, and they're precious. They're precious. So before I get all verklempt, resources. There are a number of great books out there. Books that I reference, books that I have used. They're not books that, like, I don't go back and use their method every single time. It's books that I have reviewed and I've taken bits of information from in creating my own methods. You absolutely can go ahead and follow the methods in these books, or you may start to see what I saw, and that's very much that, again, this is art. And everybody's methods are a little bit different, but ultimately have the same result. And yeah, some of them will just do things in a slightly different order or just approach it a little bit differently. But ultimately, you need yarn, you need dye, you need an acid, and you need heat. And as long as you have those basic ingredients, you're gonna have colored yarn. But certainly, if you want to get into trying new approaches, if you want to look at a more scientific method, you're looking to mass produce things rather than be a strictly indie, small batch dyer like myself, try these books. They're fabulous. The first one that I'd like to show you guys, and a lot of these are secondhand, so they look kind of rough, is The New Dyer. This is Sally Vinroot and Jenny Crowder. It is an older book. You may be able to catch a secondhand copy on like Amazon or half.com or any of the other craft sites. I think there is a recent new publication of this. This particular book is very, very scientific. They weigh everything. Everything is high measure. It talks about dyeing a number of different materials, different bases, wool, silk, cotton, rayon, jute. They talk about so many different aspects of dye. You can dye anything with this book, anything. I think you could dye a car with this book. They are extremely detailed and scientific and technical. It's a great reference, but for a brandy new beginner, it's going to be a little bit overwhelming. This is definitely a higher end. Once you've played with it and you want to learn more, then you get into a book like this. Good standard book. One of the first books I got when I started to play with dyeing is the Twisted Sisters Sock Workbook. This book doesn't seem like it would be a dyer book. However, at the very beginning, they talk about dyeing yarn, they talk about dyeing fiber, and they issue a number of different techniques. This is great. It even talks about mixing shades. It talks a little bit about different types of dyes. Love it. Love it, love it, love it. And it talks a little bit about application methods to get specific results for knitting certain socks. In addition to that, like many books that talk about dyeing hand-dyed yarns, it has a number of patterns and information in it. Really a fabulous resource. It even has a pattern in here for making toe socks. I love it. Will I ever knit toe socks? Probably not, but I love wearing them. So yeah, if anybody ever wants to surprise me, there it is. I love toe socks. Different heel variations, different sock knitting methods, but ultimately my use of this book is for its dye methods. And I'm just going to give you a flash of it there. Great, basic, beginner level, interesting, with nuances toward more advanced. Love it. New in my pile is this. I believe this is a brand new publication. I am in love. This was put out by Interweave. This book is Dying to Spin and Knit. It is by Felicia Lowe. Fabulous. Excellent book. Big format, bright colors. Again, it includes lots of different dye techniques, both for fiber and for yarns. And it talks about the different results you can get with each technique, which is wonderful. And beyond that, it has patterns for each of those techniques to make the most out of the yarn that you create. So if you just want to dabble and play a little bit to create yarn for yourself that you're going to knit, you can look at this, you can look at the sample of patterns in the back, say, yes, that's the look I'm going for. How do I make that yarn? And backtrack to the dye technique that'll produce that for you. Brilliant. Well laid out. Again, beautiful, beautiful colors. Excellent photography. Multiple methods. Detailed method instruction. Photography through the steps, which is lovely. Talks about everything that you need, the equipment, the all of it. All of it. If I were to say anything negative about this book, I haven't found it yet. I haven't found it yet. They even talk about color theory, color harmonizing, blending, mixing color, all of it. All of it. Really fabulously put together, excellent resource. Well worth the $26.99 US, $33.99 Canadian. Highly recommend this. Also, recently purchased, I picked up Kathleen Taylor's Yarns to Die For, Creating Self-Patterning Yarns for Knitting. Again, this is an older publication. It is an Interweave as well. This one has a lot of projects in it and not nearly as many dye techniques as Felicia Lowe's book. Lovely, don't get me wrong, but a little bit different. It has a couple techniques that the other book doesn't have, but it is nowhere near as extensive as the book. Still a great resource. I enjoy it. I'm keeping it on my shelf. Recommended. That is about all I have for books that talk about dye method. They're fabulous. I love them. They're excellent resources. But sometimes I end up on the wrong end of the dye method. What does that mean? Sometimes I've already dyed the yarn, but I don't know what to do with it. And I think we all experience that. We go to the craft shows, we go to the wool festivals, we go to our favorite local yarn stores, and we buy these gorgeous, hand-painted, variegated yarns. They're stunning, they're tonal, they're kettle-dyed, they're self-striping, they're speckled, whatever. They're beautiful. We look at them, and it's like candy. Must have. Then we get home. What do I do with this? How do I optimize this? How do I make this the best possible thing? How do I create a project that is knit worthy of this yarn? Stumps me all the time. I got a ton of yarn that I don't know what to do with. The beauty of this book, and this book are that they connect the dye techniques with projects. They also take the time to lay out a skein, show you how to read the skein so that you know how the dyer did it, so that you can connect it to a project. So if you're not a dyer, you can still get the information you need to connect it to a project to get the look you want. Brilliant. Love it. In that same respect, there are a couple of publications out there that specifically do this, that specifically help you read a skein so that you can interpret it for a proper project for it. Among those are these couple of books. This is a much older book. I got it thrift out of, I think, a library sale. I'm sure it's still out there somewhere. Debbie Tomkes is the author. Hand-Dyed Yarn Craft Projects. It's out there somewhere. She has some wonderful ideas for different smaller projects to utilize hand-dyed yarns that are creative and fun and make the most out of these colors. And she does have a few dye techniques in here for you. Not to the extent that the other books I showed you did, but it does have a lot of color theory in here and information about how to connect projects. Wonderful resource is Lorna Meiser's of Lorna's Laces. She's brilliant. She's brilliant. Her yarns are stunning, but she tells you how to use them. The woman's brilliant. Knitter's Guide to Hand-Dyed and Variegated Yarn. Fabulous book. Absolutely amazing. She takes you right down through all the different yarns and says, this is how to make them look their best. And has a bunch of projects in here. She talks about combing the colorways, activating colorways, double stranding to get different effects, how to evaluate your yarn, how to use stitch patterns and texture to make the most out of it, how to compare your gauge swatches so that you can get predictive pooling. We love predictive pooling. Just an amazing resource for connecting your yarn to a project. I love this. I can't say enough about it. It's big. It's on a lovely tactile, I could touch it all day paper, and it smells nice. Yes, I'm a book person. Also in the same thread of things is the Knitter's Palette. This is a workbook of color and texture techniques and effects. This is not so much for using hand-painted yarns. It's more of color theory and how to mix yarns together so that if you have a couple of different solids or you have a variegated and a solid, it helps you see how to make them dance with each other very nicely. It's a great book for general color theory study, and this is what I use it for. There are a number of different palettes in here and color wheels in here, as well as introduction to color families and tones and hues. I use it more for when I'm trying to get a specific effect out of a yarn. Sometimes when I'm playing with colors, I'm looking to aim for an emotion. Sometimes I want the colors to be joyful. Sometimes I want the colors to be calming, like I did very much for the Intention Knit Along. I went very specifically into the meanings of colors and how they work together to activate different thoughts and emotions and just different intentions. This would be a fabulous resource for anyone looking to do that with their dyeing. So there, I've shown you my dye library. If you have any questions about any of the books that I've shown today, feel free to contact me. I'll provide you as much information as I can without violating copyright. We need to network. We need to elevate our art to the highest level possible, and I am hopefully right on the forefront of encouraging you toward that. So ask, please ask. Donna, again, thank you so much. You triggered, obviously, this huge discussion, and my bookshelf is groaning in joy that it's not under so much weight for the moment. My absolute pleasure. It was a joy answering your questions, and I hope you're having fun with it. So, I think that wraps up everything for today. I've got a sleeve I want to go knit, and I want to get that off the needles. I want to start my next sweater. And hopefully, when I announce the winner of the travel knitting giveaway next week, I'll be wearing my new sweater. Fingers crossed. Again, anybody has any suggestions about my collar, weigh in. I'd love to hear from you. If you still want to join the Intention Knitting Knit Along, hop on over, go grab a kit. I'd love to send one out to you. And I otherwise will see you all next week. Have a good one. Bye.